stand and worship.
Jesus, the name above every other name.
the only one who could ever say.
We have communion today, so after the message, have these pre-filled cups if you're here in person. If you're at home watching, please get those elements ready and we'll take it all together. Finally, for offering, we have a few different ways to give. Here in person, there's an offering box, and then you can find other options online as well on the website. Let's get back up one more time to sing the next song.
Oh, Welcome everybody. Can you believe it? We are in March right now. I can't believe that already a couple of months have passed and we are now starting this spring season. We just want to welcome you, whether you be here in person or watching online at home. We're just so glad that you are a part of Zoe Church and what God is doing through the greater Orange County area. Well, let me start out with a question real quick. Have you ever had an idol in your life? You know, maybe it was a singer, maybe it was a movie star, it could have been a leader, or maybe an athlete that you admired. When I was growing up, I really got into basketball in middle school, and my friends also got really interested in it, and it got to the point where we wanted to practice all the time. And so we were just scouring different neighborhoods and different places so that we could go to a basketball court, and because our ultimate goal was to make the basketball team for our school. And this was a little bit more challenging because I lived overseas, and so we had to find creative ways to get onto the U.S. military base in Seoul, South Korea, because they had a wood floor basketball court. You know, you gotta understand, my school, we had a carpeted sports court, right? It was pretty nasty, it's pretty ghetto. Even to this day, our alumni, we kind of joke about it, and it's like a running joke where we say, hashtag, my gym was carpeted, right? So we suffered a lot when it came to this basketball experience. We even had nightmares of having carpet rug burns all the time, right? And so we kind of bypassed that. And the funny thing is, some years passed, and they eventually put wood floors in the gym. So go figure, right? During that time, we started to have to get to a place where we had to choose a favorite NBA team, right? We wanted to follow and learn the moves of these different superstars and these types of things. And so my dad was actually from the great state of Michigan. And so I started following the Detroit Pistons. You guys might remember, depending on your age, Isaiah Thomas, Dennis Rodman, and Bill Laimbeer. They were known as the bad boys of the league. And they actually won a couple of championships. But there was another star that came about around that same period of time, and not only did he take the league by storm by scoring in bunches, but he also was able to just dominate the league and eventually eclipse the Detroit Pistons and lead some of the greatest NBA teams of all time. And I'm talking about none other than, you know his name, Michael Jordan. And so he had a kind of swagger, he had a different style that was very unique to himself. He started the whole trend of wearing baggier, longer pants. I don't know if that's popular again. You know, you go through these fashion cycles where every 30 years, the fashion repeats. Is it shorter shorts or is it longer shorts? And just kind of goes back and forth. Short haircut, longer haircut, a mullet, non-mullet, you know, all these types of things start happening. But while he was dominating the league, he had that particular kind of style with his shorts. And even though he did this, John Stockton, if you guys remember him from the Utah Jazz, he refused to the bitter end, and he made sure he wore those short shorts no matter what, even though Michael Jordan was dominating the league. So I followed Michael Jordan, and it got to the point where, you know, I kind of wanted to be like Mike, right? I wanted to play like Mike. I wanted to do everything like Mike. And he was the one that even revolutionized the shoes by having little air pockets in the Nikes, right? Which we now know are our Air Jordans. And I just love the fact that he would just fly and just glide to the basketball hoop. You know, recently I looked on a website because when I moved to the States, my first birthday gift was the blue Air Jordan 3s. Right? They were made out of fake iguana skin. Okay, I mean, this is how sophisticated it was for that time period. And I looked on a website recently, and the retro version of those shoes is $300 right now. So I mean, they still hold value, and anything that has a little sign on it, it is dominated by him. But slowly over time, you know, what started off as a curiosity about the sport of basketball, all of a sudden led to me idolizing the greatness of the biggest superstar at that time, MJ the Airness. My whole life kind of started to shift in a lot of ways. My time, my resources, my energy started moving towards this obsession of this particular person. And if we're really honest about things, isn't that something that most of us has probably experienced in our lives before, where we have at a certain point started to kind of lift up or put someone up on a pedestal, someone or something, because we're all searching for a hero, right? We're all wanting to be a part of something that is what you would say is superhuman, a cut above. And in the passage that we're going to be looking at today, we are going to be seeing something that took place that became a really a cornerstone of the people. What we see is the people returning from Israel on the second exodus from their exile to Jerusalem, and they're being led by Ezra, who we were introduced to a couple weeks ago, and he is in charge of managing these leaders so that they would be able to restore worship in the house of the Lord. But he is told at this time that the Levites have actually compromised in one particular area of their life that is very, very close to home. So if you would turn your Bibles to Ezra chapter 9, verses 1 through 4, we're going to see this problem that emerges. And this is actually part one of the issue. You know, in life, we're filled with so many different distractions. But if we're able to establish spiritual rhythms in our lives, we can stay the course. Next week, we'll be covering part two. But this is part one, starting at Ezra chapter 9, verses 1 through 4. Let me read that for us today. After these things had been done, the leaders came to me and said, "The people of Israel, including the priests and the Levites, have not kept themselves separate from the neighboring people with their detestable practices, like those of the Canaanites, Hittites, Perizzites, Jebusites, Ammonites, Moabites, Egyptianites, Amorites, you name the ites, they were all in this list. They have taken some of the daughters as wives for themselves and their sons, and have mingled the holy race with the people around them. And the leaders and officials have led the way in this unfaithfulness. When I heard this, I tore my tunic and cloak, pulled hair from my head and beard, and sat down appalled. Then everyone who had trembled at the words of the God of Israel gathered around me because of this unfaithfulness of the exiles. And I sat there appalled until the sacrifice." Now, why was Ezra so distraught about the intermarrying of these Jewish people with the sons and daughters of the neighboring people? Let me first point out and clarify just right off the bat. We're not talking about interracial marriage right here, okay? That's not what we're talking about right here, okay? I know that's where our minds may be going. You know, some of you guys that might have watched the West Side Story musical or the remake of it, or the one that came out a while ago, you know, you realize that that brings up the topic of the interracial marriage, I think around the civil rights time, right? We're not talking about that. You know, I don't know if you guys cling on to that song, but I always think of that song, Maria. You know, don't worry, I won't sing it to you guys right now, but it's just one of those things that really highlights this American kind of Caucasian guy falling in love with this Cuban, Puerto Rican girl, and the rest is kind of history. But we're not talking about that. What we're talking about, people that are marrying without having the same faith as a common denominator, a foundation in their lives. Now, let me share with you something like that is so true. You know, it's hard enough being in a marriage where two people actually share the same faith. Okay? I'm witness number one of that. Can I get any other witnesses from people that are with us right now? Okay, amens are just like pouring down right now, a lot of hands going up, right? because it's hard enough. But then you throw this other angle of not believing in the same God or even worldview in your life, and what ends up happening many times is being spiritually incompatible leads you to have many times, in a lot of ways, a conflicted life. You know, what ended up happening in this particular situation with these people that were intermarrying right here was usually what ends up happening is people that are what you would call unequally yoked, right? That's a term for people that have a different faith. Marrying is that eventually maybe a follower of Jesus ends up giving up many of their convictions or their beliefs so that they can just kind of get along with their spouse, right? And their in-laws and so forth. But what ends up happening is they're not able to really live a full life after God, right? They can't be like David, whose heart was fully committed to God. It wasn't a perfect life, but it was God that was fully surrendered to God. What ends up happening is you start to actually fall into the category of Solomon, who we find out was a great king. He was actually the one that built the original house of the Lord, but he was known as marrying all the women of the land, right? He had a harem of women, and he ended up having what was called a half heart towards God, a divided heart. This leads us to our first principle that you'll see up on the screen right here, which is spiritual unfaithfulness leads to diluting the faith of its very essence and power. Spiritual unfaithfulness leads to diluting the faith of its very essence and power. Now, so that you can further understand a little bit about what was going on, maybe a little bit of the characteristics of the people that inhabited the land around Jerusalem at this time, the Canaanites, let me share with you some of their beliefs. Okay, the first one, there's three of them, that made them distinct and different from the Israelites. The first one is that they believed in false gods. They believed in gods that were like statues and different things like that, right? And so as a result, they didn't believe in the true God of Yahweh. And they were what you would call polytheists. And they believed that there were many gods. We were just, if you know a little bit about biblical history, there was the god that was named Baal. And he was the god of storm and fertility. And he was the king of the gods. He was like the equivalent of Zeus for the Greeks, right? Okay, he was the king that sat on the mountain and so forth. And there was Asherah, who was symbolized by the Asherah poles in the scriptures. Okay, so that was number one difference, okay? Number two is that they took part in sexual sin, okay? Now, let me once again clarify what that means, okay? Guys, sex is actually a good thing. Okay, I'm going to repeat that one more time. Sex is a good thing. Turn to the person next to you and say, sex is a good thing. Really, I want you to say that to you because we need to know that, okay? Sex was created by God, okay? Sex is actually a holy thing, but is reserved for the context of marriage, okay? So that's the difference that was going on between what made the Jewish people and the followers of Yahweh separate than all the people in the rest of the land that took part in things that were outside of the context of marriage. Third, and this was probably the most detestable, I guess you would say, right? I'm using the words of Ezra right now, but also very disturbing was that they had a practice of sacrificing their children to the god Molech. Now, I just kind of scratch my head when I think about this because it seems so, like, not relatable to me, but in a lot of ways, it would be the equivalent of us not treating people with dignity and of value. And so they would sacrifice their kids whenever a calamity would take place. So, for example, when there was a famine, when there was a war, when there was a bad crop, they would literally sacrifice their kids on a fire, right? And that's just one of the weird kind of things. But, you know, that's in a nutshell, guys. They were idolaters that shifted their allegiance from the Creator to the created. Okay, in a nutshell, that's what it was. And the reason that Ezra reacted in such a drastic way by tearing off his clothes and ripping out his hair was for two things. Number one, he was concerned about the personal well-being of these priests, these Levites, right? And how they were doing spiritually. But he's also concerned that their credibility was taken away, right? Because how can you lead if you're not living the life, right? There's no way that you can stand and tell people what to do if you're not doing it yourself. Now, let me give you an example that's going on right now of leadership and integrity when it comes to that. Some of you guys have been following what's been going on in Ukraine, and we have two contrasting leaders that are represented in this war that we're seeing play out in Ukraine and Russia, the invading armies. Vladimir Zelensky, who is the president of the Ukraine, one of the things that he has chosen not to do is he is not ditching his people. He is in Kiev, and he is telling everybody that he is going to hunker down and be there to the bitter end, right? And his family is somewhere in the Ukraine as well, right? There's a t-shirt going around right now. You might have seen the quote somewhere in the news sources and so forth. But he's when the U.S. And the allies said, hey, we can airlift you out and take your family and so forth. You know what his response to that was? I don't need a ride. I need more ammo. That's what he said. Okay, now this is contrasted with Vladimir Putin, who is sitting in Russia, isolated, and kind of away from the frontline combat while he sends his soldiers to do all the dirty work for him. Okay, I saw a picture recently where Putin is sitting at a long table. You might have seen this somewhere. He's sitting at a long table. He's by himself, and his cabinet is like way at the other side of a table. You guys remember Beauty and the Beast, where the Beast is over there, and she's sitting on the other end? Well, the cabinet's over there, and that's how he conducts his meetings, right? And it really reveals his autocratic style of leadership, which is basically my way or the highway. You know, that's what it comes down to. Now, who would you rather follow? Would you rather follow Zelensky, who really thinks about you, or Putin, who thinks about himself? Things that no brainer, we all understand. Now, let's continue with verses 5 through 9 as we start to see Ezra get back on his feet while praying. Then at the evening sacrifice, I rose my self-abasement with my tunic and cloak torn and fell on my knees, with my hands spread out to the Lord my God and pray. I am too ashamed and disgraced, my God, to lift up my face to you, because our sins are higher than our heads, and our guilt has reached to the heavens from the days of our ancestors until now. Our guilt has been great because of our sins. We and our kings and our priests have been subjected to the sword and captivity, to pillage and humiliation at the hand of foreign kings as it is today. But now for a brief moment, the Lord our God has been gracious in leaving us a remnant and giving us a firm place in a sanctuary. And so our God gives light to our eyes and a light relief in our bondage. Though we are slaves, our God has not forsaken us in our bondage. He has shown us kindness in the sight of the kings of Persia. He has granted us new life to rebuild the house of our God and repair its ruins. And he has given us a wall of protection in Judah in Jerusalem. What we see here is that Ezra is able to recover a bit because of God's grace, his steadfast commitment, and his forgiveness to this remnant people. He's giving a second chance. And the greatest thing about this is that Ezra is recognizing in the midst of this difficulty, in this time that his people have compromised, in this time where he's actually getting attacked by all sides, he remembers who God is in his life. Now, all of us can say, probably without a doubt right now, that we are in a season of prolonged difficulty and anxiousness. Would you agree? Right? Whether we be transitioning a little bit back to school, to work, even our families. I know there's a big push right now in the workforce to return to work, and what this means with all the different masks rules and, you know, all testing and these types of things. It's actually causing a lot of stress, right? A lot of anxiety for moms, for dads, everyone involved in coordinating this kind of shift back to normality. And this can bring about a lot of difficulties on top of the global crisis right now. I was talking with someone before service, and he said that overnight, in his area, gas went up by literally a dollar. Man, that takes a big chunk out of your budget, regardless of if you fill up at Costco or not. Okay, I mean, no matter what, it's just difficult. Okay? Here's the thing, guys. When you're feeling horrified or offended by a disappointing season that you're confronted with in your life, remember who God is. like Ezra did. Ezra called out to God, and he said in Hebrew, Jehovah Jireh, you are my provider. Jehovah Rophi, you are my healer. Jehovah Shalom, you are my peace. Jehovah Shammah, you are always there. Jehovah Nisi, you are my battle fighter. Jehovah Rophi, you are my great shepherd. And Jehovah Siskenu, you are my righteousness. You are our righteousness, and therefore I can stand in battle. Therefore, I can take on anything that comes my way. Not only did he remember who God was, but he remembered whose he was. That's a key difference, guys. When we are in the arms of God, we can take on the world. And we are seeing that example play out. You know, one of the things that I am so impressed in these times of difficulty, and you know, we reflect upon this. Don't we get a lot of perspective in life when we see what's going on, especially with the difficulty and the hardship of those that are in a more difficult situation than us? I mean, there is turmoil, there is death right in front of the people's eyes in the Ukraine area. There is just bad stuff that only emerges in times of war. But even in spite of that, we see the people of God as well as other people that are made in the image of God, sending their resources, helping people that are displaced. I heard about this Airbnb thing. Have you guys heard about this? Where people are reserving Airbnbs in the Ukraine so that displaced people can stay in Poland and Moldova and the Czech Republic and these neighboring kind of areas around there. And they have no intention of checking in, right? They're from all over the world. They're allowing for these people to come in. That mindset and that generosity emerges when you know whose you are in your life. Because you know that God is going to take care of you regardless of all the difficulty and challenges that you're going to face. If anything, you're paying forward. Because you never know when something in your life is going to change literally overnight. Right? I mean, I was watching some of the stories coming out right now. And this one lady said on Wednesday she was taking her kids to school to piano class and all these different things that were going on. And then the next day she gets a call early in the morning from her mom saying the Russians are attacking. Wow. Who would have thought that would take place? But the very same thing can take place in all of our lives. Nothing is guaranteed. We live in a broken world. Guys, we always have to have that perspective that this is not the end. That this life is actually a very small segment of the life that we were planned for before we even came to the earth. And that we have a short time on earth, but then we have an eternity in heaven. When you have that perspective, where do you invest your time? Where do you invest your resources? Where do you invest your prayers and your focus? It's really about that time that goes beyond time. The unlimited time that we can be a part of. When we say yes to Jesus, the fact is that we are his beloved and we are safe in his arms. God's mercy triumphs over judgment all the time. And God is slow to anger, and he is loyal to his people. You know, I've been using this term because it comes out of the scripture over and over again. His hesed is reigning over us. What is hesed? It is his relentless, reckless, and loyal love to his people that he has covenanted with time and time again. And so this leads us to our second principle, which is hate the sin and love the sinner. You've heard this before. Hate the sin, but love the sinner. You know, our tendency many times is to do the exact opposite just because of us feeling somehow that we're not loved or we're not feeling at a good place in our lives. But let me ask you a couple of questions right now that I think will help us understand this idea a little bit more. Do you have a deep emotional response to sin in your own life, in our lives, as well as in your camp. What that camp means is your community, right? Do you get to a place where you're appalled by that, right? We should. Number one, why? Because that's God's heart, right? God doesn't want any of us to get hurt as a result of our shortcomings and sin that many times is born out of selfish motives and these types of things, right? So we have to be at a place where we're appalled by sin in our own lives as well as in our immediate communities, people that we actually know, right? The second question is, are we pained and grieved just like Ezra was, or do we choose to judge or condemn? You know, see the difference here? Our tendency is to look at the faults of others and actually give little grace and mercy to people, right? That's just all of our defaults. That's our fallen nature. How do you get to a place where you reverse that and you allow for compassion to reign more and more in your lives? I think ultimately it comes by a life that is filled and empowered by the Holy Spirit's presence. When that happens in our lives, then we really get beyond trying to change someone's behavior, and that being the end, to getting to the heart of the issue and trying to examine what's really going on in someone's heart. And that's when transformation can take place. You know, it's really hard being a parent. Man, I'm gonna get a lot of amens after that, or like high fives, right? It's really hard being a parent. I feel really sorry for my parents. And by the way, my parents watch every message online, so hi mom, hi dad. Thank you for putting up and dealing with me for 18 years of your life, okay? Now we have three kids, Susie and I have three boys. As each of them got added on, you know, I remember when Ian came, and he's in the room right now, he was our first, and so we will always treasure our first, and I feel bad for him because we experimented on him, you know? Everything was like the diapers, just everything was a first-time experience, and like we made so many mistakes, so he's like our guinea pig, and I feel bad for him, but God knew he was going to be the firstborn, so he could withstand that, but we love him so much. And then our second was Lukey. You know, when he was born, he was the youngest one, so as a result, he got all the attention, right? But then all of a sudden, we had a surprise baby. You know, some of you guys, I don't know if you've experienced that before, but surprise, I'm pregnant. And you're like, oh man. And you know, we're all happy, but all the guys are calculating dollar signs in their minds, right? That's just kind of how it is, right? And we're like, okay, can I stay in California? I don't know, this place is too expensive. You know, all those kind of thoughts kind of reign in our lives. But when we got our third son, he burst onto the scene, and all the attention shifted from the middle child. I feel bad for middle children. I don't know if any of you guys are middle children out there. But okay, I see a lot of hands pointing to each other as well. But all of a sudden, the attention shifted to our youngest one, Jordan. And during this time, you know, like, Lukey's trying to navigate the situation, trying to figure things out. And recently, he's been kind of exhibiting some behavior where it seems like all he, you know, he's just trying to like, you know, kind of like get his own way and just kind of like just push his agenda, you know, whether it be with us or his friends. And, you know, Susie and I are kind of getting frustrated. We're trying to nip it at the bud, and we're just telling him, you know, Jordan, you're being so selfish. Luke, you're only thinking about yourself, you know, these types of things. And we start scratching and thinking about it a little bit more, and we're just like, you know, it's not changing his behavior. Something's wrong with what we're doing. Our approach is totally off. And we started to peel the onion layer a little bit more. And we started to kind of like talk to him about what he's going through and so forth. And we realized that we weren't getting at the root of the issue. And the root of the issue is he needs us to engage and to listen to him a little bit more. Probably more than even our other sons. Even his personality needs a little more interaction than even our other sons. So we got it all wrong with him. And Luke, you know, Lukey, bless his heart, all he's saying is, guys, I'm still here. Don't forget me. You know, I'm the same Lukey boy, right? And really what it is it's a cry for help. You know, that's really what's going on there. Now, this does not in any way excuse his behavior, because no matter what, there are consequences to that, right? We're not saying that you kind of throw the baby out with the bathwater in your parenting or whatever issue that's going on. But really, it's a change in perspective where we need to kind of parent him a little bit different than the rest of our kids in a lot of ways because of him being the middle child and so forth. Now, one of the things that I really admire about Luke is his ability to apologize and say sorry relatively quickly. I mean, when he is told about something, he's like, oh, I'm so sorry. And he starts crying right away. I'm like, oh, it wasn't that big of a deal, bro. whatever it might be. But he has this way about him. That's just really something really cool that I've noticed about him. And what we see in our passage today is that Ezra was able to do the same thing and confess on behalf of his own people. I highlighted our in the passage that you read over there, because he was doing this on behalf as a representative for his people that had compromised in this area in their life. Now here's the application for today, it's twofold. First, and this is a lost art of the church, guys, that we have lost over the years and we have to learn and relearn over, because the goal of life, guys, above all things, is to love, right? To love God and love people better. We're in this life so that we can improve on what it means to love, right? And so the first application is confessing our own personal shortcomings. That's the first thing that we need to do. We need to start with ourselves. Is there anything that we have to get out of the way before we talk to other people about things, right? So make sure you're right with God before you lovingly move on to your community or your camp. And then number two, confessing on behalf of your family's sins. That's really what Ezra did. He saw these priests and these Levites as his brothers in Christ. And so he cried out and he interceded on their behalf. Let's go ahead and continue with verses 13 through 15 as we see a little bit more of his confession, a prayer of Ezra. What has happened to us is a result of our evil deeds and our great guilt, and yet, our God, you have punished us less than our sins deserve and have given us a remnant like this. Shall we then break your commands again and intermarry with the people who commit such detestable practices? Would you not be angry enough with us to destroy us, leaving us no remnant or survivors? Lord, the God of Israel, you are righteous. We are left this day as a remnant. Here we are before you in our guilt, though because of it, no one of us, not one of us, can stand in your presence. You know, one of the things that I really admire about Ezra is that he just owned this. He didn't make excuses. He didn't rationalize. What he just said basically at that point was, God, you are righteous. And before you, we actually don't deserve a second chance. We shouldn't even be in your presence because of your holiness. But what does God provide? He actually provides a way out because of his mercy, because of his loving kindness, because of his chesed love. And that's our third principle, which is God is faithful and just to forgive. And this is precisely why we need Jesus. And this is why he came to the cross, so that we would be able to release and remove our shame and guilt and our sin. You know, some of us have lived our lives with shame because of what we have heard from our parents about how we are not good enough. We are not, you know, whatever, you know, beautiful enough, or we have too much weight that we're carrying, whatever. All these exterior types of things. But what God is saying to us today is that I don't even see you by those things. I see you for who you are. You're a child of God, and your identity is fully fixed on me, and I want to build you back up to a place where you recognize whose you are and are able to walk boldly as a result. No, life isn't going to be easy, and you're not going to still battle those tapes that you rehearse in your mind and get you down from time to time, but you will still be able to get to a place that you know that you're secure and that God has a perspective in you that is unconditional. His love is one that doesn't change because of your performance in a lot of ways. Now here's the last thing I want to say before we go into communion. You know, a lot of us settle and substitute something that is counterfeit or to get temporary relief in the form of idols that I kind of talked about a little earlier. And another way of putting it is that we exchange the giver with the gift. Okay? We settle for things that only temporarily kind of relieve our anxiety and our fears and all those different things. But what we are being reminded of today, or maybe even for the first time today as you're listening, is that the key to being able to overcome and to stay on course is to hold on to the giver of life. The giver of life, whose fountain of life will never leave you thirsty, will never leave you dry, will always quench your hunger for life and everything. Not only for this life, but for eternity. And that is God. And God sent his son Jesus to this earth so that you and I will be able to experience a little bit of heaven. If we don't have that, our life is filled with bad news. And it could be even put up on whatever news source we see out there. Broadcast to the world. But what we see is actually God coming in with good news, where he wants to heal and he wants to bring just hope back to the brokenhearted. And that might be you sitting here right now. A lot of times in our lives, we try to fit a square in a circle. And that's why we hit a wall. That's why we deal with the same issues that keep coming up. The insecurities, our feelings of inadequacy. Yes, we all have those thorns in the flesh. But the reality is, we can turn that very weakness into our greatest strength when we place it in front of God and allow him to be increased and to be glorified, even in spite of that in our lives. That's what God promises in us every day. You know, only Jesus meets the deepest longings and yearnings in our soul. And it starts with what we talked about earlier, and this is the main takeaway. It starts with our confession. When we confess it to God directly, as well as people that we love and trust us and will show us grace, then we can start over and have a brand new day that allows the darkness of the night to be replaced with the refreshing of the morning. But it doesn't happen just at the strike of midnight, but can happen at 12 noon at work, when you've been battling a difficult situation, or you're worried about your kids at school because of all the shifting COVID protocol or whatever it may be. You're able to go to God and find refuge and restoration because of that confession to God. I need you right now. I need you to take away this fear from me right now. Lord, help me today and in the next few hours. So at this time, we're going to just invite our worship leader to up and go ahead and take communion at this point. And so if you've come here in person, make sure that you have one of these pre-filled cups. If you're at home, go ahead and have your elements ready. But I'm going to go ahead and read a couple verses here that really summarize the two different sacrifices that God made on our behalf through Jesus, his son. It was the body that was broken for us, as well as the blood that was shed for us. And so let me read 1 Corinthians 11, 23 through 26. It says, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Let's go ahead and eat this wafer or bread together. He continued by saying, "In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Let's go ahead and drink juice today. Would you join me in prayer? Father God, we just come to you right now with open arms, open hearts, open minds. We need you, Lord. Lord, although we live in an area that on the outside seems like everything's going so well, Lord, our hearts could be in the exact opposite position. Lord, but because of who? Because of your Son, Jesus, Lord, you loved us so much that you sent someone to this earth that experienced every single pain that we experienced. Whether it be rejection, whether it be being made fun of, whether it be ostracized or tempted in an area of our life that for whatever reason rears its ugly head when we are stressed out, or just the result of being in a broken world that we live in today. Lord, it's so easy to get our hearts and our eyes shifted off of the course that you have set before us. Lord, we stumble, we fall. But Lord, you are right there to pick us up. And Lord, when we remember your grace, we remember the living hope that you have given to us through your Son, Jesus. Lord, we can fight another day. We can fight even another hour, Lord. Lord, would you restore each and every one of us with whatever issue that we're dealing with right now. Lord, the cross answers that in each and every one of our lives, Lord. So we call on to you. Lord, cover us with your grace. Cover us with your righteousness. Cover us with your blood. Thank you for being broken for us. We lift you up in the powerful name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. Can we all stand right now as we sing this song of praise to our God?
Worship your majesty.
Offer that up to God. God doesn't respond with anger, but he responds with grace and wants to bring us back into the fold. So hold it onto the heart of confession as we try to stay on course. Hey guys, we'll be finishing off our series of Rebuilding next Sunday with part two of the message today. So hope to see you next week. All right, have a great week, guys. We'll see you.